So, the traits of obstructive sleep apnea. I will, and I am going to give you some practical exercises that you can take home. But there is a little bit of theory, and my presentation is a little bit drier than our previous two. At the same time, I want to try and show you the research that's behind it. So we spoke about that. During wakefulness, the airway is held by the high activity of the numerous upper airway dilator muscles. But after the onset of sleep, when muscle activity is reduced, the airway collapses and you stop breathing. And it happens when the negative pressure generated by breathing exceeds the dilating force of the upper airway muscles. And I think this is really important to recognize. I want to reduce the negative upper airway pressure, but I also want to get the dilating upper airway, I want to get the upper airway dilating muscles working harder. How do you get these muscles to work harder? And how do you reduce the negative pressure during inspiration? And those are the two things that we look at. It's a common disorder. If you stop breathing completely, it's an apnea. Or if you have a reduction to the flow of breathing for more than 10 seconds, which causes a blood oxygen desaturation of 3 to 4%, it's a hypopnea. That's the AHI index that was developed by Dr. Bishop Gibbon. One of the previous slides, it showed an individual having an oxygen desaturation of 65%. SpO2, SaO2 down to 65%. I use breath holding with athletes as intermittent hypoxic training, and we do that to force the body to make adaptations. We can never or hardly ever get an athlete, and these guys are physically trained, super fit, they're able to tolerate a very high air shortage. We can't get them to drop, we don't want them anyway, but we cannot get them to drop their SpO2 down to 65%. 65% is at the top of Mount Everest, 8,843 meters, probably at about 26,000 feet. At some point, I'm going to hand out a number of pulse oximeters, and we're going to mimic an apnea. And I want you then to feed back to me, how low were you able to drop your SpO2? How can a human being involuntarily stop breathing to the point that your blood oxygen saturation drops down to 65%? If you try it yourselves, if you desaturate by 10%, you're going to do pretty well. So, despite the quantity, if you're doing a polysomnography, despite the quantity of the neurophysiological signals obtained, most of it is ignored. And the AHI is the main index to be looking at. But there's shortfalls with the AHI. You can have a patient who has very long breath holds, that they stop breathing for a very, very long period of time to have a severe deoxygen saturation. But that will be only considered as one on the AHI index. And furthermore, you could have somebody who has more frequent events and a much higher AHI, but they don't desaturate very often. So in terms of that individual, they will have more severe sleep apnea. But do they really, when you weigh it against the individual who is just a small AHI but desaturating to a large extreme during sleep? In addition, non-apneic respiratory events that do not meet the scoring criteria for hypopnea. It's activating the sympathetic response, but they're just under the radar. They are not included within the AHI. And furthermore, two papers showing that the total AHI correlates poorly with the key causes and consequences of the disease. There is a change happening in the last 2 to 3 years looking at obstructive sleep apnea. Traditionally, it was thought it was an anatomical model. Open up the airway. But as Dr. Hank showed this morning, you've seen a number of people with good airways, but they still had sleep problems. Anatomical, the upper airway can collapse at one or multiple sites, the pharyngeal and structures. So basically the genioglossus, or the tongue, most of it forming the genioglossus, or the saphenous palate, or you can have collapse in the pharyngeal walls, or the epiglottis. So you've got four sites that are potentially due to collapse of the upper airways. And in recent years, the potential role of factors beyond pharyngeal anatomy and craniofacial structure play in OSA pathophysiology have been recognized.